Hey everybody, welcome back to the Council of Reach. Where are we? What is going on?
Episode 50!
Episode 50, we're coming at you from the Dave Cave.
It's spectacular, it's new, it's invincible, it's... All new.
All different.
In shambles.
Your study hole is a boot.
Yes. Dust boot?
Oh, it is a boot.
It's a shoey.
Biggest load of bullshit ever, that was.
Let's move on from that.
It's not like this.
Yeah. Okay, I guess I need to introduce us again.
I guess so.
Why?
It seems weird doing an episode 50, but whatever. Okay. I'm Dylan.
Just like comic books, man. Everyone could be there for every issue. Exactly. Could be there first.
That's right. I'm Dylan. I'm here with Jason.
G'day.
I can't remember which order I went. Fommy.
It doesn't matter normally because you change it up all the time. Hey.
Nitin.
Hello.
And Dave. Yeah, master of the Dave Cave.
Poppy cherry in my cave.
Somebody's got it.
Yeah.
It ain't going to be you. Yeah.
Okay,
classy as always.
Very. Okay, our comics of the week were Step by Bloody Step and Ghost Rider.
Ooh.
Number one.
What do you want to start?
I suppose. We've got some new comic announcements to talk about as well.
Some good stuff.
New creative teams on Batman and Ant-Man. Got some new figures in the shop this week as well. Thank you for that.
Some old new.
For people just listening, that was Jay touching figures.
Oh, Spider-Man got a good rub.
He got a good tap.
Tapping.
Double tap.
Okay. Also, me and Fommy finished watching Cuphead Show. Yeah. We're going to talk about that. How awesome that was. You also watched Kingsman?
Yes.
And we're going to go into... So Nitin's... Wait. Your film flashback.
Hims.
Hims, films, flashes, backers.
The Babadook.
The Babadook!
The Babadook.
Duk.
All right.
Yeah, we'll get to that.
Let's get into the comic books.
Cool. All right, let's go Step by Bloody Step.
Oh, baby!
Tell me about how great it is, Dylan.
Okay, this was very interesting. I ordered this.
Yes, I did.
Look at David. I mean,
that's what you can do with it. It's a silent story, so it's the only way you can sort of...
I saw this in previews, and I just thought it looked cool, so I ordered it for myself, and I didn't really even know that it was completely silent, no dialogue, apart from some gibberish.
Mm.
And it kind of makes sense. Yeah. Essentially, the issue just follows this giant night golem thing as it's carrying this little girl and protecting her from monsters and stuff. What do you think of it, Jason?
I think... It was good, but I think the art is too fancy. I think for a silent book, you need to be a bit more simple and a bit better at the storytelling. I shouldn't get as lost as I was. Like, you know what's going on,
but
there was a lot of pages that were not clear enough.
Yeah,
I think a silent book needs to be drawn more like a storyboard.
There's a bit in here where there's like an upwards water torrent and you have no idea why or what.
There's just too many weird panels and like it's too artistic. It's nice, it looks great, but I think a dialogueless book needs to be a bit more nine-panel-y.
But don't you need a bit of mysticism in a book to get you to come back to read the second one to see maybe you might find out about that mystical spout of whatever the hell it is because it's leading you on a journey? Because like I agree, and the hard part, I do partly agree with the art. But I also think we've also been treated to a lot of really good art recently in independent books that have done brilliant storytelling without much writing, like Thirst of Vengeance, Primordial did that at the start, May's book as well. So obviously there's nothing in this, but you still need to... Like, I did honestly text everyone, like, what the hell was that? But I still enjoyed it.
Oh, yeah.
But I still just... I don't know every... part of it because that I don't think they want you to yet.
No, that's the journey of the story.
Exactly
the
right.
Story. And it's only a four-parter.
Yeah,
I think.
Yeah, four-parter.
Yeah, it's very European looking art.
The art is gorgeous.
Art is fantastic,
but I think it's a bit overcomplicated for what it is.
I don't mind it being complicated because I felt like without the dialogue, I had a lot more time to spend just looking at the art and pouring over it. And I do agree there were some panels. It was a bit. Like, I couldn't really follow.
Yes.
I couldn't really tell what I was looking at.
A couple of times and just see where if it did follow, but it didn't.
Yeah.
So I'm like, okay, well, there's a reason for that.
It was mainly those smaller little panels that are kind of on top of the pages.
I think one of the problems for me, too, was that it's like a double-sized issue, which is great, but Well, about halfway, I was a bit bored, to be honest.
Yeah.
Like, not bored, that's not the right word, but I didn't care. Because there's no story to make me care.
I kind of liked...
was just walking.
I kind of liked how there wasn't really anything, because you're usually told everything, right? And I just felt it was really cool to just get thrown in and not necessarily know exactly.
It's a good way of putting it, too, because you really are. Like, in this... this medium, we're throwing everything. We're not only given the dialogue, we're given the art as well. Yeah. So people like Dave can be happy during reading books. But you know, this side of it, I enjoyed the read. I'll check the next one out. I think it could be a good trade. But then again, it might
be too long.
Then it might have the issue of what you were saying. So I don't know.
Yeah, I'm not sure about that as well. Yeah, it might be a bit too.
But a four-parter, I don't think that's what.
It's not a big.
I don't know if they'll all be that long either. I think they might have
go back to normal pages
for the rest of the series. Perhaps they did that just they gave you extra in this first one because there was no dialogue. I don't know. They didn't want you to feel like you're getting ripped off, but I don't think you were.
Yeah, no, I enjoyed it.
Different, something different. I'm loving different independent stuff at the moment, and I'm still enjoying what the top two tiers are bringing out, because there's some really good stuff they're bringing out, but I'm really enjoying the independent stuff at the moment. So
yeah, they've been knocking out.
They really
but
have.
Definitely, if you like something different, check it out. Yeah. Like it. My reservations about it might be because I'm too dumb. And that's perfectly fine.
Let the imagination soar. Go on, Jay. Let it soar.
I just did that. No imagination. Cool. You get the big sort of... review thing, and I'm like, yeah, what's next? Where's some words, bro? And I don't like reading!
You got gibberish words in it, though.
That's true.
That didn't help.
I wonder if you got, like, an everyday comic book, and, like, if you didn't read the words, took them all out, and would you still get it from...
Depends
like,
on the people.
Panels, yeah, really.
Yeah. Yeah. If it's a Bendis one, then no.
Because it'd just be without talking the dialogue.
Heads. Yeah, heads like, talking.
Everyone just looking
righteous... You could work Righteous out without the words. Obviously, there's so minimal anyway.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it's very... It depends on the storytelling talent of the artist.
Yeah.
You know, some guys can draw the greatest splash pages but can't pace a story to save their life. Where some dudes...
McFarlane.
Yeah, you know?
And that also could be a problem there, because, like, you got the writer, but they lay out, like, what the scene is, but then it's up to the artist.
I would love to know how... the writing work, like how scripted it was.
Yeah.
Like, was it full Marvel style? Like, bang, here's the plot, go for your life? Or was it a bit more of a script page breakdown, like all the modern writers do?
Remember when Marvel did the Nuff Said
month,
year, like, over a decade ago? And like, every book was silent. They had, like, the script in the back.
Yes.
I loved Garth Ennis when it was, like, 2 pages for Dylan.
Yeah, because he knew, one, he'd work with Dylan so much, that it's just like, cool.
But then it was
Punisher shoots some bad guys.
But then the Chris Priest one for Black Panther, that was very detailed. Yes. Everything was scripted and plotted out and
That's how they all write these days, pretty much, you know? Like, I would say 90% work on a very screenplay style these days.
Christopher Priest, yeah.
Like, cool. Sense. Page one. Panel, you
know?
Yeah. Which I don't like. I like the Marvel style, why Stan was done out of mainly necessity. And he had everything. A great talent pool to work with. I just think it makes for better books.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Because then...
it's more collaboration.
Yeah, yeah. Like, someone else who isn't an artist isn't dictating the composition and stuff. Right. Yeah.
I think... yeah. Next. Ghost Rider.
How was Ghost Rider?
Great.
Ghost Rider was good.
Yeah.
I was a little... I was really digging the previous Ghost Rider series where Johnny Blaze was King of Hell. And that got cancelled at the start of the sort of pandemic and... I felt that was clearly cancelled prematurely, and I wanted to see more of that. And then this is going to be a back-to-basis Ghost Rider.
This kind of undoes all that
stuff. Yeah, yeah, or just... no, I wouldn't say ignores, but...
you were going to see where that goes.
Yeah, where the stuff comes back to it later.
Yeah.
But it was a messed up issue.
It was excellent.
Very,
I had a flick through, and I just saw all these zombie people. Man, I can't wait to read this, and then I forgot to read it.
It's a fat issue.
It's a great issue.
Yeah.
I enjoyed it a lot more than I expected to. I hadn't read that last... the only last Johnny Blaze I'd seen was when... in Avengers, when the other Ghost Rider was down in hell, and his hell was being stuck in traffic.
Yeah.
And that's when Johnny was running in hell. I saw bits and pieces of him there, but really enjoyed this book. The whole head accident and the seeing double and seeing other things that aren't exactly what they are. Damn dog death. Poor dog.
Yes. It's also, I will say, very new reader friendly.
Yes. Big time.
Like, you don't need to know anything.
On. Great jump on point.
Anything. Because nothing is really referenced in it overly, you know?
When I asked about it in the shop, I think, and after reading it, I think you gave me the best explanation with the, of kind of what's going on. Like you said, it's moved on from the King in Hell, but it's kind of like Stafford Wives. Mm. Everything's perfect. He's in this little village where everything's perfect. He's got his wife, he's got his kid. And then things through the episode start to break down, and seeing things for what they really are.
Mm.
And yeah, I'm actually really keen to see what happens in the next issue, because I always like Johnny Blaze. I like him a lot more than the current Ghost Rider that they're doing so much with. I know Jason Aaron loves him, but I really dig the original. Not, I know he's not the original, but you know what I mean. Yes.
And like, the more of a Ghost Rider fan you are, you know straight away things are not right.
Yes.
Because of who's around, shall we say. But yeah, it's very twisted, and like, this would make a great TV show.
Oh, for sure.
Very, it's got that Moon Knight vibe.
Mm.
You know what I mean?
With a WandaVision kick.
What's what? Yeah. What's not what?
Okay, cool.
Yeah, you know, because Johnny's going, without getting too much, Johnny's going to his psychologist,
yep,
to psychiatrist, whatever she is.
Yep.
Because he's had the accident. He's, yeah, he's
head injury.
Not right. Yeah, he's got a big scar.
Yeah.
But it's all's not what it seems.
Mm. Oh, that scar when it opens up with the eye later.
Right. Yeah, oh, you know what my favourite bit was? Yeah. Baseball.
Oh.
Kids playing baseball.
Oh.
Mate.
Mm. Yeah, it's definitely worth a flick. If you're looking for a jump on point, it's an easy read. It's a good read, and I'm keen to see where it goes. Because I want to bring Johnny Blaze back.
Mm.
And I think they want to bring him back into the U properly. Yeah. So, come on, Nick Cage!
Nick Cage!
Glasses all. Back into the plastic bottle.
But
very good.
And Percy.
Yeah.
I'm really enjoying Percy's writing. I haven't read much because he's been doing a lot of Wolvie,
yep,
and everything like and X-Force, stuff, yeah, and I don't read a lot of X-Men after I got burnt with Arthur Hickman stuff. But through that and this X-Lives and Deaths of Wolvie, I'm really enjoying his writing. So, yes.
That is very messed up.
Yeah. Yeah, very
it's
much
It's dark.
So. That's not what I expected.
It is dark and twisted. But,
speaking,
yeah, really good.
Speaking of dark, ooh, and twisted,
this was a surprise packet and a half, yeah, this week. Carnage Forever.
Yeah.
Two stories.
For some reason.
Yeah.
And that first story was, I kind of thought that first story could have been the second story, because the second story is kind of the story, I could guess what they're doing, where they're leading the main story into the next book,
yes,
at the end. But it just kind of felt like that was thrown out,
yeah,
of nowhere. You'd put that story second. It almost felt like the black, red, and white.
Yes,
Carnage.
Very much. It's very.
I was like, "Where's
much.
The third story?"
Well, there was.
Well, the Venom of the symbiote gang,
whatever.
Yeah.
So your first one is Philip Kennedy Johnson with Edgar Salazar, and Kennedy Johnson's done a lot of the symbiote stuff the last
recently,
year or two. And then the second story is Ram V with LaRocca, which leads into the new Carnage ongoing. And Ram V obviously co-writing Venom, so obviously I would say those books might eventually come together. But this was, very good. First story, a little homeless girl.
Yeah, well, yeah, girl that's got junky parents,
yeah,
you probably say.
Well, I don't even know parents.
Well, junky, yeah, whatevers. And
I think that's just picked her up along the way.
Yeah, and she's just outside this burnt down orphanage, church orphanage. Yeah,
yeah,
same thing. People kind of looking out for her. A certain guy coming past, making sure she's okay. And then she falls into the scaffolding and meets up with a certain friend who helps her along the way.
Yeah, for people that don't know, Carnage is just the symbiote these days. There's no...
Yes.
Cletus is gone. Sort of. You know what I mean?
We'll get to the next story in a second.
Yes. So, it's sort of more like...
So, the last time we...
Possessing-ish?
Yeah. So, the last time we saw Carnage was... It was like a... He was a shark. You're like, so, you had the Venom Island stuff... Venom ripped him apart. He sinked off into the fire and he kind of went into the ocean. And then we saw that Black, White and Carnage episode issues where it was the shark and then went onto the ship, onto the fishing boat. So it's just made its way back, but 100%. It's just the
The black symbiote. That's supposed to be not in continuity.
But that one was a Donny Cates, yes. And it kind of, he was writing Venom 100%. At the moment. So I counted that one. Yeah.
Cause especially because it came from the...
And it was Bagley doing the arc. Yeah. Yes. So yeah, this is a... It takes a really dark trip, as you'd expect in regards of a Carnage story. But it doesn't just have the normal psychopathic killing of, you know, people doing the wrong thing. There's a lot more darkness to what you think would be the good part of the story, or the helpers in the story. So
it was great. I think I liked the first story much better.
I really did, yeah. Because Kenny Johnson's been doing, like, he did Extreme Carnage and a lot of the Carnage stuff recently, not just Symbiote stuff. So I like what Ram V's doing with Venom, but I think I would have preferred to see him or McCloud maybe do the next Carnage. Clay McCloud's been doing great stuff as well, so...
And the second story is Carnage going seeing another Spider-Man villain that's locked up, and that was pretty interesting as well.
Very interesting. Nitin's on it now. There's a set, the way he gets into the facility through the smoke alarm system, but instead of the water coming out, it's the shards of the the Carnage symbiote shattering into their skin and and killing them. One of the Rogues Gallery of Spider-Man. It's a really weird little interaction. I don't know. It's going to come out more during the
book, I would imagine.
The book,
Because being a one-shot, I was not overly fussed. I was like, both these guys, okay, they'll be good. But it was...
I didn't realise really it was good. One-shot. I thought it was the start of the new book of Carnage called Carnage Forever. So, yeah, I don't know. I enjoyed it. I'm going to keep buying it because I like my symbiotes and I enjoy all those writers, so... Yeah,
it's good. These people are looking at books too slow. Don't know if they haven't got to it yet.
No.
Moving right along. Human Target, Book 5. Obviously, some sad news this week that this book is going to go on a 5-month hiatus soon.
Piss me off, DC. You finally got me reading your books. And then
I'll say, congratulations, Smallwood. It's because he's having a baby. Yeah, so he's taking some time off. I understand, but I think they could have maybe scheduled the whole book a bit better.
Bring him out bi-monthly, guys.
Such a great book. With a mystery sort of book to go on a break that big, I think it's a bit of a worry. The only smart thing is they're going to put the 1-6 hardcover out just before 7 comes back.
Oh, okay.
So we've got one more issue to go before it goes on break. Mm-hmm. So that's at least a smart idea by him. Like, bang, bring out the first 6 as a collection, then it can return. But for us that have been reading it singly, it's going to be a wait. But man, what a issue this was.
Yeah, so after all that bitching book of the week, I read it twice. I read it and then I went, that's so damn good and I need to take that in again. I need to read that again. So we get a Martian Manhunter issue-ish.
Yeah, it's like 4 stories going on the page.
Concurrently.
Or concurrently.
Yeah. So is it up to issue 6? He's got 12 days to live. He's been poisoned. Yeah. 5 days to live. He's been poisoned. Issue 5.
Yeah.
So we've got one more to come.
And poisoned, he was pretending to be Lex Luthor. And this story is just getting deeper and deeper. We meet Irma from Titan, who can read minds and is teaching him how to stop people from getting into his, or give them what he wants to give them as opposed to what they want to take out of his mind, and teaching him how to read people's minds at the same time. Being, it is just such a damn...
And during that we get basically his origin.
Yes.
And motivation to why he is the Human Target.
And then so much more at the back end in regards to everything that's unraveling around who has poisoned him.
Mm.
You get some real big cliff notes at the end, I would probably say. The art... Again, we're only annoyed because we're enjoying the book so much and just want more of it every month. So, like, it is what it is. Like, if it's so good, I can't complain to say, you know, just keep giving us more.
So good. Yeah. But it's not an easy read. Like, it's not hard as in, it's demented. But
it jumps around.
Complex.
Each sort of panel is very, a different story.
Not linear. Turning around.
Yeah. It's really good, though.
The art is good enough to give you the cues.
Big time.
Just like subtle stuff, like colours and stuff, right?
Yes. But you got to pay attention. I was reading books late last night, and I started this one. I was like, this might wait till the morning.
Yeah, yeah. And it's so worth it with the big reveal at the end. The way they've plotted this story has been sensational.
Yeah.
It's almost... Is it going to finish by the end of this year?
No. But yeah, it's so good. Damn. Like, the colouring is amazing.
Yeah, it's really, like, very 60s.
Yeah.
Style art.
Colouring. Yeah, and
yeah.
Very, very
I had to talk the art up to Dana today. I know you don't care, yeah, but I'm telling you this and just pretend like you give a shit, all right? Look at this art. She's like, yeah, it's really nice. I'm like, yeah, but look at the style. She's like, yeah, it's good. I'm kind of like, okay.
Yeah, no.
Say what I need to say. So good.
Well, while we're on Smallwood, he's also got a story in Electra, Black, White and Blood.
Mm.
Issue 2, obviously Black, White and Blood, 3 stories. He does, I think, the last one. A silent one. This is how a silent one should be a bit more done.
For Jason.
Yes.
For Jason.
The first one, Peter David and Greg Land. Ooh. The most un-Greg Land looking stuff I've seen in a while. Oh, so
he's actually drawing instead of tracing it?
Yeah.
I can still see
the tracing. You can still see the Greg Land, you know?
That's Trace for sure. Yeah, I can see it from here.
With Wolverine, that was great. And then the second story is Al Ewing and Rodriguez. And then Smallwood writes and draws the third story. They're just Elektra. You know, like... Electra saving people, Electra killing people.
Electra 100 is coming out soon.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Just a with anniversary one shot sort of thing.
Writing,
yeah. This is very good. Like, these anthologies, they're short stories. There's not a lot to tell you about, but this one was really good. The first issue of Electra was good. This one, I think, was much better. All three stories. Like, this first one was great. Like, coppers trying to work out who's murdered someone, and the video footage doesn't show it, and they're like, they realize, oh, it's because 24 frames a second, who could be fast enough? And all you see is like just a red, like her Dennery sashy thing. And that's all they call it. So that was really good.
Very cool.
Yeah, patch, Madripoor stuff. So that was good. That coming up soon if you're an old school Wolverine fan. Yeah, all these black, white, and reds have been really good. Bloods or whatever they call it. It's only going to be hit and miss when you got 8 to 12 pages to tell your story or whatever.
Well, they have been, but like the Carnage ones were good. Yeah. What's the other ones we got? There was...
Deadpool.
Yeah,
Deadpool.
Was there Wolverine? No, it was...
Yes.
No, it wasn't. Yeah, yes. The Wolverine ones were great.
There's Moon Knight on the way.
Oh, I can't wait for that.
Yeah, because that's...
First one's Hickman and Bacala.
There you go.
I haven't picked up any of these, but I should probably pick that up.
Yeah, for sure. For sure, for sure. Alrighty, Knitting. Everybody's favourite knitting artist. Food on Girl Scouts number 3, 4? What are we up to?
4.
How was this?
It continues to be good. It's very weird. It's Jim of Food weird.
Yeah.
Just continues on with trying to get the ashes of her dead boyfriend back and why the teeth wants it, which is the villain. So, yeah, as I said before, it's set in space and in the future from the regular Girl Scouts sort of
universe. Yes, she's a descendant.
Yeah, she's a descendant of one of the original Girl Scouts. Not even one of the originals, one of the other Girl Scouts. The original Girl Scout. So it's not Gwen and Daphne. Or
Yeah,
it just continues to be great. Jim Food's great friend, artist.
Yeah.
Look at his pouches and guns from this dude.
Oh, wow.
Jim Full.
That's Natas.
Rob Liefeld.
Which is Satan Backwards. This was Book of the Week before I read Human Target. This weird little book just gives me so many good feels. The character development, it's just such a weird... once again, the asses he draws are sensational. There's this mad orgy spot that inside this guy's psyche that they're in. And he's like, can't we just hang out here for a little bit? She's like, no, we can't. We've got to go. And then, the Natas at the end just balls out Terminator over-the-top guns and ridiculousness. And then they get their sweaters back.
Nah, his art's like no one else, right?
No.
Yeah, seriously.
But it's not just that. It's the plotting of the book and the crazy paneling.
The layouts.
Are just spectacular.
He does that stuff well.
Yes. So well.
Oh, and because it's so rough, but...
It's rough and clean.
Yeah, right? It's hard to...
Just very... It very graffiti in
art. Oh, yeah, big time.
It's fantastic. Like, no... non-straight lines and weird, paneling, and it's great. It's more fake. Is my favorite artist.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's the page.
Yeah.
Like, and odd coloring on throughout. It's not all. Three color.
Sort of.
Coloring. No, Jim of Food's great. I buy anything that he does, even random covers.
You even got me to buy a bloody shirt.
Well, I say it all the time. He's even his handwriting is so distinct.
Excellent. Oh,
I got a package for Nitin at the shop. I know who it's from. Since I see Nitin. Like, nobody writes Nitin like food. Nobody.
Well, he does the lettering and stuff in the book himself. He does.
And he's when he writes the addresses, it looks like he's letters.
And if you're ever worried about your partner dying and then being repossessed, you should maybe have a secret word when they say something, you say something. So like a little catchphrase or something.
Call and response.
Call and response. Probably worthwhile because they may try and kill you.
Well, I don't think there's going to be
much of a problem,
but you never know.
Never know.
This one was actually supposed to be out a couple of weeks ago, but missed in my boxes, but we got it this week. Pros. Finally read this.
Yeah. What happened? I picked this up mainly because I saw it advertised in... Geez, I've been reading a lot of AWA Upshot books. Mm-hmm. But I saw Al Madrigal's name there, and I'm a big Bill Burr fan, and him and Bill Burr started All Things Comedy Network, so it's like a comedy network that actually helps out all the comedians, and they get paid all the royalties and stuff and don't get screwed over by different managers and stuff. So I thought I'd pick it up. He's a cool artist, comedian. I also liked him in, there's a TV series called I'm Dying Up Here, which is kind of like the Comedy Store in the 70s and stuff. The first episode had Sebastian Stan in it and stuff like that. It's really quite funny and talks about, like, there's a Richard Pryor's in and everything like that. It's really, really cool. So this book, Al said there wasn't enough Latina as he was growing up enjoying Latina superheroes and characters. So Primos is Ricky. It's him and a couple of people that he's hooked up with. I don't want to give you too much away, but yeah, it's a cool little story. I enjoyed it, but it probably wasn't... I'm not definitely the target market. But yeah, there's some cool mystical stuff around the Mayans and coming back around different people. His brother getting taken and other things going. It's a pretty cool little story. I reckon definitely if you're in your late teens, early 20s, liking a crazy out there story in regards of what they're talking about, like the Mayans going through space back in the day. And some cool totem stuff in there as well. So yeah, cool little book. Worth picking up. Again, just another little independent, something a bit different. A little bit of a flick if you want, boys. But I'll get the rest and keep checking it out. Yeah. But bit different. But I don't want to say a little bit the same as well. But yeah, you can tie it. It's not vanilla, but it's not balls to the wall because it's got to keep people standing because it's not going for the crazy adult audience, I think, as well.
Yeah, because it looks more like a traditional superhero-ish kind of thing.
Not traditional. Back in the day, like Telos and all those kind of things came out, those kind of style, but I don't know. It's fun.
Yeah, the art's pretty cool.
Mm. Ooh, what's that?
What's what?
This one.
This one is Batman the Knight.
Is that the Jock one?
Oh, no, this is the Chip one.
I don't think I picked the first one up.
Oh. You didn't pick up the first one?
I'm sure you did.
I don't think so.
Oh.
I did.
Anyway.
Yeah, I think
Batman the Knight by Chip Zdarsky.
Can't wait to read it.
Obviously, I'll be very interested if this goes anywhere with Chip taking over the regular Batman book upcoming. But this is the origin Batman stuff. First issue was okay because Chip's good, but
didn't
quite grab me. Just because the Batman origin stuff's been there, done that. Yeah. But this one was really good. I really liked this issue. So this issue, young Bruce is buggered off to Paris to... He wants to learn from the best, but he doesn't know how to find the best. He's like, you know, the best... If they're advertising they're on the best at something, they're usually not the best. Yeah. So
cool.
He runs across a female cat burglar who takes a bit of a liking to him, and he's going to teach him how to be a cat burglar, basically, because how are you going to stop the best cat burglars? That's how you know. You got to learn it yourself sort of thing.
Sure.
So that was really good, actually. I really liked it, just their interactions. The art is really nice. Carmine de Giglio-Melanello, I find. I hate these. This is why I don't like these talking dick, because I can't say nobody's name. This is great. Great. So he goes out. Chick's breaking into somewhere. And he's like, stop, you're under arrest or whatever. And she's like, that's a terrible accent. And then the next day, he's at a cafe. And she just comes up onto him. and says something to him, and she's like, oh, your accent's got better since last night. Is that because I called you out on it? And he's like, well, if I fail, I learn to be better, or whatever, you know, some bullshit like that. And yeah, it's, yeah, she's teaching him stuff. Whether I think, you know,
nice.
Take the fall for stuff, and but it's really good. Because this is the stuff I want to see. If you're going to do pre-Batman, show me him. Like, you know when they did, Snyder did Year Zero?
Yeah, yeah.
The main story I didn't like, the little backups I loved. Like, him learning how to sort of drive. And, like, doing the skills. And this is all this was.
Yeah.
Mm. So this is really good.
And it's kind of like a different angle on it too, right? Like, yeah. I think Batman Begins kind of touched on it, where he became a criminal to very kind much. Of learn how they work and stuff.
Because the whole book, he's definitely torn by that, like, you know, I'm breaking the law too, yeah. You know, and how, where do you, what justifies, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
But yeah, very Batman Begins.
Mm. That's interesting. Yeah. Because I wasn't too won over by that first issue.
No.
But what you're telling me, I'm like,
this was good. Yeah, yeah, bunch, like, the first one. There's only a couple of... The bits with the girlfriend were interesting, and the Hugo Strange stuff was interesting. But for the most part, there's a lot of whiny little rich boy. Mm. Where this is rich boy doing cool stuff with his toys.
Not whining.
Yes. but yeah, really good.
Mm.
Really good. So I can't wait to see where it goes, though. Because 12-parter or 10-parter? 10-parter. 12-parter?
10.
Yeah, good stuff. Alright, next up on the bar, Ben Reilly's Spider-Man. Obviously, this is a flashback to when Ben Reilly was Spider-Man the first time in the 90s, Clone Saga era. Not current Amazing Spider-Man Ben Reilly. But first issue was good, a little wordy, a little setting up and explaining for new readers. Like, Ben Reilly's Spider-Man was 25 years ago. So, like, I understand trying to set where he is and whatever.
Yeah.
But this one, still a bit wordy, but it's, that's the 90s for you. But this is cool. I really like this, actually. It's the end of the first issue. Scorpion comes into Ben Reilly's apartment and attacks, and like, he knows who Spider-Man is, the Ben Reilly Spider-Man.
Oh, oh,
that's okay. Thrown him off. So they go have a fight. At the same time, Ben's going and so making new friends.
Is that a recap, or is it like just a story?
It's just an untold story, shall we say? Okay. Untold tales of Ben Reilly, I guess, would be the best way to describe it.
Because the new one, like, people know, right? Like, he's not exactly hiding it.
Oh.
No. Like, the rest of the community, superhero community, know it's not Peter, yeah? Or not, no, it's a different guy.
But probably, what, it's just the company that kind of knows who he is?
Yes, yeah. The Beyond.
But it's not like he has a public identity.
No.
Right. Not whatsoever.
You know? Like, Captain America and Black Cat know it's not the same Peter Parker they've known all their life, but... Yeah.
Hmm.
Well, Black Cat knows a bit more.
Black Cat knows a lot more.
Yeah, you know, she's in on the whole. She knows who Pete is.
Anyway, we'll get to that.
But yeah, this is good. Good fun 90s style. Nice. It just feels like a superhero stuff.
Bit of chameleon.
We'll talk about it later when we get to another one coming up. Oh, actually, we'll just go next.
Let's go to that
straight
next.
So good. Same vibe. Silver Surfer Rebirth, issue 2. Dude. Just 90s gold. This book is excellent.
Ron Lim. That
it might be book double. For me.
It was so close. Like, again, I read that first, and then I read Girl Scouts. I'm like, oh, that was better. And then I read Human Target. That book.
Yeah.
That double page of him and Thanos.
Yeah.
You got to show the peoples that are watching that. If there's anyone watching, I hope there's someone watching. Yeah.
This one. Yeah. Run in 90s. Some silver gold. Look at that.
Yeah.
Oh. It's cool. Beautiful. Okay, so last issue, you had Captain Marvel, like, Marvel back alive, and Silver's like, whatever, how? And then he turns into Genesis Vell, and it's like, what's going on? So this issue, it's set back in, you know, it's a flashback tale. So it's sort of post-Infinity Gauntlet, and, like, Thanos is explaining to Surfer. Now, after the Infinity stuff, all the gems got separated. Warlock kept the Soul Gem, the rest of the gems pretty much were given to Infinity Watch to look after, and Thanos himself got... given back the reality gem for safekeeping. And somebody has stolen the reality gem for Thanos. So he needs Surfer to help.
He's putting the team together.
Mm.
It is excellent.
Yeah. It's just 90s. Just superheroes, man.
And it's so fast paced.
Oh, bro. And like, nothing really happens.
No, but it's excellent.
Nothing really happens.
Yeah. It's a lot of books this week. So yeah, it's really, it's up there. It's top five.
Yeah, sure. I just...
And yet,
it's
I love
a simpler
that.
Time.
You've got your way of getting around. I've got mine.
Comes the so damn good.
That's so cool.
And like, I love Ron Lim. I've always liked Ron Lim. And like, he's Silver Surfer especially. Like, that's what he's made for.
And I just love the way it's finished again. They're separated. He's there. And then, yeah, Nebula's there at the end.
Yeah.
Let's start again.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, I really, really, really enjoying it. Very good book. Just fun.
So much fun. Cosmic superhero stuff. I can't believe how much I'm digging that book. It's crazy.
Yeah. Just simple. And like, not only is the look, but it's just the way it ends on a cliffhanger. And episodic, which I think is a problem in modern day comics where everything's written for a 6-issue trade. Things are not quite as... That's one of the things lost of why the old comics had
still. Yeah. I'm flicking through a comic and then it just ends on nothing. Like, not like a big something that happens at the end.
Yeah.
And that's such a staple for old comics.
Because you want the next one.
It always ends on something really big.
It makes you come back.
Sometimes it's like end of a conversation and, that's the end of the issue. Like, what?
Yes.
See, but that doesn't really work with modern comics. People have just put it on the standing order. Back in the day, it was like,
of course,
on
of
a stand, you want to new stands and, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
People didn't have standing orders.
Yes, of course. But, like, it's still just like a TV show. Like, it's got to be its own three-part act sort of thing, you know what I mean? It's still got to...
Well, like Batman back in the day, you have the first show on the Tuesday and then be the cliffhanger into the Friday.
Yes.
Never know if he's going to if they'll survive.
Because it's the problem with episodic television these days. It's because binge-ness is not. It's just
and everyone now complains if something's episodic.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
I love it, but people complain. They can't. I'm like,
just make it 5-hour movie then. Anyway, that's enough old man ranting.
Where are those clouds?
Oh, right. All right, Dark Ages number 5. This book has been good. This book was pretty damn good again.
Damn good.
Yeah. So. Last issue.
Save it. I haven't read it yet.
Last issue, bad stuff happened. They lost a member of their team.
Sorry.
So it starts off with a funeral, and they're in Europe. The kids are along, and they're freaked out. That what are they going to do with the kids? Can't send them back. Can't leave them here. Doom. Did you see that bit?
Yeah.
Yeah. You read it? Yeah. Doom, that was bad. Doom up and Pete.
Yeah.
That was great.
Give giving Peter Parker parenting advice.
Yes. Deadpool, like, I'm not the biggest Deadpool fan, but this is where Deadpool shines.
Yeah, it was.
Interacting with other heroes.
Yeah, when it's like a bigger cast and he just kind of shows up and says something dumb.
Yeah.
And everyone's like, what?
You're an idiot.
Yes.
Yeah,
the one who makes Peter Parker look mature.
Yes.
I don't know, I was underwhelmed by
it. It's not the craziest issue. Yeah.
Like, the first couple of issues were great.
Yep.
The last issue was a bit meh. Like, same with this. Like, towards, until, like,
the end.
I'm like,
the Goblin Rides weren't good.
Bloody fireworks factory already, basically.
Yes,
just, it's taken so long to wrap up the story.
I thought this was the weakest issue yet.
Yeah.
How many are there total?
Two more, I think?
Yeah.
Two more after this? Okay.
I was a little disappointed.
I thought the next one was... Next one's...
I just didn't feel I got enough out of this.
Okay, one more.
Yeah, one more.
Yeah.
Yeah, it just seems like it either needs to be a double-sized issue to conclude that, because...
Obviously, not spoil what's on the cover, but like...
Yeah.
When Miles shows up with the...
Yeah.
Two symbiotes combined, it's like, oh, wow, it's going to be awesome.
That, the fact that it's Miles
who's
the combined symbiote.
Yeah, that was really cool, but I felt like there was not... I don't know, like...
Well, they dealt with that pretty damn quickly.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It was very quick.
It was a flashback.
It's all it was.
For sure. Too much... Too much character work and not enough just...
Action.
Yes.
Yeah.
Mm.
Like at the start of the episode, and I know they're at a funeral at the start, but you've got Giant Man riding Fing Fang Foom and then you don't see him again in the whole issue. And I'm like...
He's got to stay in the water.
I know. Well, does he?
That's his job.
Yes,
protecting.
I know.
He's the, guardsman.
Oh, that's right. Damn it.
Now, the whole thing, I think the book needed to be longer. So I got more, maybe. Because I also would like to see more of Apocalypse and his crew.
Mm. Yeah.
You get, two pages of it.
Yeah.
But, yeah, like, the symbiote, this new symbiote thing. Look at that. So it's Venom and Carnage, both combined under Miles. Like, what the hell?
That's so cool.
Yeah, you really wanted more of that?
But, like, there's one issue left, and you're going, Tony Stark's doing his own machinations?
Yes.
Sort of, all right, it just needs to be a double-sized issue.
Yeah.
My bad.
Yeah, probably not a bit.
Oh, I have to go out with a big double, yeah. double issue.
How cool is the Doctor Strange thing?
Yeah,
that was great. Awesome.
Yeah. Can't touch him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's excellent. What have we got next?
Oh, are you chair?
No.
No, it's not.
Things falling over Dave's face.
Dave's got robots in his Dave cave.
Ah, gotcha. Alright, DC Vampires, that's up next.
Oh, I caught up on this.
Yeah, how good is it?
Yeah, it was awesome. Like,
tell your face.
Yeah.
You don't like it?
Don't lie, Dylan, just say
it. Great.
It's okay.
No, it was cool, but it's things that you kind of just have to, I guess, suspend your disbelief, right?
Of course.
Yeah. Like,
well, from the get-go, when Green Lantern's out in the sun and... No.
Yeah, but like...
I guess his little...
What if you make the sun?
Green aura protects him.
Yeah, he's got like an energy shield or something.
Yeah.
But stuff like, you know, you were talking last time, like Wonder Woman gets turned. And
yeah, that was
all these other people get turned.
Thanks for spoilers.
The Wonder Woman one, I thought was... already. The Wonder Woman one was too easy.
Because it gives you basically an explanation.
Yes.
He uses his magic vampire hypnotizing and stuff, but...
She worries she should go down fighting a bit more.
But and it boils down to... Batman beats everybody.
Of course.
What's the difference in art here?
They're different stories. Different. Yeah, that was a bit jarring.
Yeah.
I didn't like the other art. Alright, well, like... Superman, yes or no then?
Oh, no, absolutely
no, right?
not, because
yeah.
he's...
But you're like, how... That's my biggest problem with it. So half the Justice... A couple of Justice League are turned to vampires, and they've got... The whole Justice League's gone... Because the vampires have told... Alright, Green Lantern and Wonder Woman are vampires, right? The rest of the Justice League rocks up to take out Green Arrow and Batman because the vampires have said these people are vampires. And like Superman and Cyborg are just like, oh,
yeah.
Okay.
They said something, oh, it's in your blood, it's an infection or something, right? Superman can look into your blood at a microscopic level and he could see that.
The two standing next to him.
Yes.
He
can freaking lobotomize people from space. Like, I understand Superman is very difficult to very difficult to write because he could do all this crazy shit, right? But you gotta keep that in mind. I don't know, have him not there, have him not on Earth or something.
Be not a factor in this story until like maybe towards the end.
Yeah.
Because last issue, I was like, ooh, is he gonna be like the head one?
Yeah.
And this one, you're like, I think it would have been so much better.
He should already be one of them because he can do too much, right? Like, he's got super hearing as well as X-ray vision. He has all these senses that... You're telling me he can't tell someone's a vampire?
Well, at the very least, like, wouldn't he not be able to notice there's no heartbeat?
Yeah.
Stuff like that, right?
Exactly,
Just something. I get his comments, you've got to look away at some stuff, for sure. But, last issue, I was like, man, I thought that's where they were going to go. He's going to be head vampire.
Because
Luther is the one that has set up and given Batman the info, basically, to save... humanity. Yeah. Like, that would have worked excellent for me. Like, that Luffy's stopping...
Yeah.
It's Superman. God damn, I told you so.
That's your way around the problem.
Yes.
How does Superman not know?
Yes. But I like I'm just a big fan of Green Arrow.
Green
Arrow's
awesome in
this. The Ollie and Batman interactions are excellent.
Yeah. Like that, Wonder Woman 2 against 1. It's like, you think you stand a chance? No, not really.
And they do talk... about Wonder Woman having no weakness and stuff. That's awesome.
Yes.
I did really like that.
Yes. Yeah, that was good.
Because they're trying to fight her and Green Arrow's like, hey, you got files on everybody. What's Wonder Woman's weakness? How do we beat her? And he's like, well, her friends are a weakness. So that... And
then,
he's like, oh, okay, I guess that's out the window. We got to just run then.
Yeah.
It was cool. I am enjoying it.
Yeah, it's fun.
Yeah.
But, like, and obviously, the biggest problem is Superman.
Yeah.
I really wish... He was the vampire.
Oh, like a fixed next issue?
Yes.
Hmm.
Might. Who knows?
Or they might explode when they try to drink his blood.
Ooh, that'd be interesting.
That happened to Dracula once, right?
Was
that
Dracula.
Really?
Yeah.
It's a sun battery.
Yeah.
Of course. That's pretty good.
Yeah. Yes. All right, next up, Berserker. You read this? Anyone read this?
Yes.
It's
read that.
Good.
That's very
really
cool.
Good.
I haven't read
a while between issues, guys.
It's always a while between issues.
But this is the new arc, so that's... Is it six?
No, they're like little four-parters, I think.
Oh. Hmm. Ignore that.
But...
I hadn't read the last issue, and I read that, and that was really cool, too.
Up the mountain, shaving his soldier mate.
Yeah.
It was really good. But this one, ooh.
Yeah, interesting. Interesting. All this cultist kind of stuff, and there's people out there that worship him as God because of all the things that he can do.
And, oh, my favorite bit is the dude, the doctor, archaeologist, sus guy, is explaining who's got the thing, and it tells you where this thing has come from. Like, you saved it, you raided it from this museum last issue. But they got it from the Nazis, and the Nazis got it from here.
That was
so
cool.
And it's just jumping sometimes hundreds of years and like all the way back to him, basically, and what it is.
Yeah, man, it's so cool.
Yeah, I don't want to spoil that, but yeah. What the MacGuffin is, for the lack of a better word, was pretty awesome. But like just the dude telling him, the doctor guy telling him, it's like technology travels. Holy hell. You are the reason why technology has traveled. You have gone everywhere. Yeah. You have seen everything.
Because civilizations end, yes, right? But still stuff advances.
You're the constant. You move on.
Wow, man.
It's so good, man.
Yeah, that was next level shit. That's excellent.
Yeah, those couple of pages where it's time, 1944, 1800,
yeah,
500, whatever, BCs.
Yeah.
Like,
I would recommend this book. Like, I was just so surprised by it when I first started reading it. It's so good.
Cool.
And the fact, like, it's all about, yeah, the cult stuff in there. It's all... And I think you also... why the cult have been always worshipping him and stuff and what they want out of him also gives you the idea of what the government want with him.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely their plan. It's sort of... Yeah, because you haven't really worked out what the deal is. Like, you know, it's dodgy government... You know they want to use him as a weapon, and they're not really there to help him, but what they really want, I think, starting to come forward. But yeah, the what's in the box? Woo!
That was so cool.
Yeah. alrighty, well, I didn't look at that. Let's move on to Wolverine Terminator 2 Judgment Day.
What?
Oh, big time.
Xdesa Wolverine.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so I realised this book is just Terminator 2.
Yes. Literally.
With the Phalanx Wolverine, he's just Terminator.
Yeah, he's just the...
He's just coming back to...
Oh, he's just going hard?
Yeah.
Okay, so he's just the last... He's come back to try and stop and save everyone. Oh, we've got three Wolverine... The Ken's in it as well, and...
X-23.
And the one with only one blade, whatever her name is.
Gabby.
Yep, Gabby.
Or,
is it Honeybadger?
Honeybadger.
Okay. Okay.
Yes.
What, that isn't a fearsome enough name for
it? So the whole thing is Moira and this doctor get together to destroy them all. Are they just making Nimrod? Is that what they're doing there?
Maybe. That's I would imagine like. So, right?
Yeah,
because
like,
he's a tech dude.
If he's a tech dude, she wants to end mutants, then it would be Nimrod, I'm guessing.
Yeah. Well, and like, the Wolverine and her stuff, like, let's go on back to the powers of X stuff.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like,
it's really weird. I still don't know exactly what's going on, but I'm still enjoying it.
Yeah.
Because
Xavier sends...
I know now why I'm enjoying it, because it's Terminator 2.
Yes. Xavier sends the Wolverine kids, because they can't send Wolverine, because Wolverine... He's already sent a Wolverine back in time over here.
Oh.
But the Terminator Wolverine's rocked up, so they got to stop him, so you send...
Wolverines.
Yeah, other Wolverines.
This reminds me of Rick and Morty with the snakes.
Yeah, pretty much.
But it was, it was good. You know, like, cause
you just need Wolverine jazz.
Yeah.
I think out of the two, generally, Lives has been more wow, because more action.
Yes.
Like, the first issue of Death, when it was like, oh, crap, this is just a Moira book.
Yeah,
that was cool. But this one, this is
and
pretty
I'm
sick.
Really keen for the next Lives, because we're going to see an Omega Red-infused Wolvie.
Yeah. For sure.
Alrighty. What is next?
Villains
of Hire?
Villains of Hire. Devil's Reign. This is cool.
It looks really cool how to flick through it.
Yeah. So it's US agent at the end rocks up, last issue rocks up and like I'm here to take run the team. So this is why and how. And you know, like him explaining to Fisk that these idiots are going to be criminals. You need somebody to look after them and babysit them and be in charge. I'm the man. And it's like, well, who sent you? I sent myself. I don't think you did. The art's a bit iffy. I'm not a big fan of that, I'll be honest. But I love US Agent. And this was cool. Like, it's nothing but good, you know? But yeah.
Interesting.
Like, when he rocks up, Thunderbolts are there to stop a robbery.
Wow.
And their Electro's trying to steal the gems herself until Walker put it down. Who are you? Oh, I'm in charge now. New sheriff in town, sort of thing.
Yeah, this art is not great.
No.
It's that rhino at the start.
Oh, the first shot, big face shot of US Agent. No. But the story was good enough that I overcome the art.
Okay, that's cool.
Because it was it was at the bottom of the pile to read, because when I looked at it, I was like, but,
well, it's Clay McLeod, it makes sense.
The story US Agent. Of it. I'm a sucker. And yeah, the tap, shall we say?
Yeah. That part, yeah, looked very interesting.
Told him someone's going to work. Yeah. Who, what, where, and why is going on? Interesting, interesting, interesting. Mummy, caught up in Spidey. What did you read, about 50 of them?
Well, for some reason, it's probably a good reason. A lot of the Beyond ones didn't get put in my box, so thank you for that.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, I'm really, really disappointed about that. Except, mind you, I think it was like Mary Jane and Black Cat together in Black Cat suits, so that might have been alright, but...
Oh, that was a different one-shot.
Yeah, that was
one-shot.
Oh, was it? Yeah. I didn't get that. Anyway, not missing it. So, I think I read from 84 to 90. Started off with Doc Ock, so that part of it was Pete still in hospital, slowly getting better. Doc Ock had just come in and helped him out, and he was well on the way to the mend. But then Doc Ock found out more around what Beyond were doing, and essentially it was just what all the superior stuff he was doing, and they stole all his data and all his tech. So he went in and got... He was taken down a lot of different... He took down Misty and... what's the name?
Colleen.
And... That kind of went by the wayside. Then Pete started training with Cap and Black Cat. That was excellent. And then it was like, oh, you need to learn how to work together. So Black Cat just had two other goons, and they're like, well, so what are we doing? He's like, well, we just robbed this place, and we're jumping this car, so you need to chase us and catch us. Like, so there was some really good stuff there. But then the last two issues, when the Queen Goblin stuff has come out, which is a massive shock. That Beyond are not only making superheroes, watch out, they're making supervillains too.
You mean the almost, evil corporation?
It almost seems like all these different people that Ben Reilly has been facing may have been set up by the Beyond Corporation, like Morbius and all the other. But yeah, we don't know who this Queen Goblin is yet. It's been excellent the last two issues, I'll be honest, because it's been Patrick Gleason writing and Mark Bagley on art, and some beautiful, beautiful art. Did you see the last page there?
Yeah.
That's a ripper.
Yeah. Bag. Nobody draws Spider-Man as good as Bag.
She's got a new goblin power. Yeah. They were taking the piss out of how many goblin foes Spider-Man now has. And they were saying that X-Men has a goblin queen.
Yep.
And she's like, no, it's Queen Goblin, because it rhymes with Green Goblin. I don't know, that's pretty funny. So yeah, Bagley and Gleason doing that. And then, yeah, she's got this goblin stare, and it turns all your negative thoughts, like, hypers them up, and you want to kill yourself. So she's doing it to Black Cat while they're both standing. She's got this glider that splits in half, so Black Cat's standing on the glider, and she just makes Black Cat just jump off in the middle of the air, and she has to get saved and stuff. And there's another bit where she does it with Pete and loses all his self-confidence, and some good stuff getting written. I'm actually not disappointed, because I don't mind Zeb Wells as a writer, but I really like Gleason. Gleason's Iron Fist from a few years ago and some other stuff that he... Oh, no, that was Brisson. Hang on. No, Gleason, I've read some other good stuff and have enjoyed his work recently, so I would have liked him to continue, but we'll see what's... But it's moving on. Like, we know Ben's going to be moving on to San Fran or something like that, or...
Definitely West Coast.
Yeah. Good to get and Pete will be back soon with that new one, but yeah, that's... I'm actually intrigued, and there's been some good MJ stuff as well. And I'm intrigued to see who she is, because she knew Ben.
Oh,
Queen Goblin. Which, yeah. But anyway, that's all I'll say. But yeah, it was good to catch up.
Anybody else read anything else?
I read a shitload more, but you guys can go.
Nope.
I read the first issue of Radio Apocalypse by Ron V.
Oh, yeah? What's that like?
Because I bought, like, the Jim Food variant.
Yeah.
Which finally came. It's okay. The art's not great.
Yeah.
But it's set in the future where something's happened and... There's literally outposts around the place. You can't be outside it at night.
Yep.
otherwise you'll get eaten. Yeah, that sort of thing. Yeah. And there's this radio station that runs, like, that just runs, I think, in this outpost. I don't know, I wasn't... The art was really putting me off, because I didn't really like the art.
Yeah.
And I just read it just because it was the first issue, I'll give it a shot. And, you know, it's just playing, just... So that adds, like, a bit of a normalcy to this messed up future they're in. But, yeah, it was okay. Issue 2 just came out, but I only bought it for the variant. And, like, issue 2 came out like this week. I'm like, I don't really care enough. Yeah. It was okay, but I don't really care enough. The art was not really put me off. It was not great. Just very messy, but not in a good way. Mm. Yeah, and other stuff, but whatever.
And we do like an ugly messy. It just has to be proper ugly messy.
Second issue of Bolero I picked up because I liked the first issue.
Oh, yeah.
It was alright. Like, it's, you know, she's got the key that has jumped into different lives throughout different places. And it sort of jumps around different hops that she does. That's what it's called. She's like, one hop is like they're in space, and another hop in like Bridgerton Abbey, sort of Downton Abbey style era.
Yeah.
One where she's a knight with the girl that dumped her, and she's all, you know, and then the girl that dumped her, she's all insane and crazy and just killing people, and she's like, I can't handle this, and leaves. But I think the way I read it, she goes back to her original life, where he's like, all the hops, like, I don't like them.
Sure.
I just go back to my original life. Yeah. And she's like, move on and just, you know, just be an adult and move on with her life.
Yep.
And then she meets the dude at the wedding of her friend, who was, you know, from the first issue. And then, you know, sort of, I guess, they're going to be hooking up throughout the next few issues. I'll pick up the rest of the series, because I like what the premise and the art and the story is going.
The art is very
pretty. Yeah, it's very, very simple, but I like it. Yeah, very anime manga-esque, but not as exaggerated. Yeah. Don't like that, really.
Dill?
I read latest issue of Nightwing. Was it 89 or 79?
89.
Picked it up because it's the first part in a crossover with Superman, Son of Kal-El. They're clever when they do that, eh? The crossovers of that book.
At least this one fits it because it's the same writer.
Yes. It feels like they did like a book of Boba Fett, because I don't know how Nightwing readers would feel. This was like a Superman issue.
Guest star Nightwing.
Yeah, because I understood basically everything that was happening. Because
you read the book.
Exactly. Yeah. It's like, oh, Superman is... John is in the Fortress of Solitude and he's talking to a hologram of Clark. Because he's like, hey, I think I kind of messed up. People are dead. Talking about this thing that happened in the last issue with Superman. So
just in a Nightwing book.
In a Nightwing book.
Do you see Nightwing?
He's in it, but there is more Superman in this book than there is Nightwing.
What if it's the other way around on the Superman book and it's a Nightwing book?
That's when I'll be
confused.
That's
smart.
Right?
That'd be good.
That'd be smart.
Yeah. That's fully just giving you a taste of the other book.
What did he do?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, just
I hope they do, actually, because that'd be good.
Mm. And there was, like a moment with John, and I'm trying to remember his partner's name because he's so boring and forgettable. I think it's Jay.
Yeah.
He's just so boring. So boring. Sometimes, and he's a journalist.
Sometimes you want to be safe.
What's your name?
Jason.
Jay, Jay, cool. No worries.
But we don't have pink hair.
Yeah, that's right. Right, okay. He's got pink hair and he's a journalist.
I was wondering what you're going to say then.
I'm not going to say
anything.
Is he going to be a super villain? I say it every time we talk about it.
I really hope so, but I don't think
so. He's
going
to make it say.
Well, do it.
If he's so boring and can't remember his name, he must not be doing anything to
be a
villain.
Yeah, but like,
he's
got the idea.
Yeah, he's got superpowers, and he runs this... I guess it's kind of like anti-media, like... it's the truth. It's called The Truth. So it's like trying to debunk all the stuff that you're hearing in mainstream, and this is the truth, and that guy's a despot, and this... You know, all that kind of stuff. So I'm hoping he's a bad guy.
Hmm.
He's got a mask, he's got an alter ego.
I'm a journalist and an expert on everything.
It's got that kind of smell to it.
Yeah.
Nice.
Is it basically Nightwing's going to be his mentorish type thing because Clark's away? Is that what the idea
is? Yeah. There was actually a really cool flashback bit in the book.
When I said that, that's what I thought that was going to be about.
It basically flashes back to when John was like a 10-year-old or something, and basically he's gotten lost because Clark was like, hey, don't go flying at nighttime because you can get lost. And because he's a kid, he went flying at nighttime and he got lost. And, you know, Clark's called Bruce, and Bruce is helping him try to find this, a superpowered kid who can fly faster than the speed of sound, right? So all over the world, they find him in a cave, and Dick calms him down a way like Bruce could never calm a kid down. He's like, hey, do you know what Bruce keeps in his pocket? And he pulls out like a lollipop. And he's like, yeah, it's a lollipop. That was cool. That was really nice.
I assume that's what the deal was, and I was like, that makes so much sense.
Yeah.
Because if you're a sort of young hero, like the big top guard would be a little unapproachable and a bit godlike sort of thing. Mm-hmm. Someone like Nightwing is
he's
like
just that.
That step down, but he's the guy that he's cool the team
uncle.
Titan.
He's the cool uncle.
Absolutely. Yes. He's not gonna go off at you too much. But yeah, like he's the team Titan, right? So
it is cool seeing them team up. It's cool.
Yeah, cool, cool.
Yeah.
If they do that story-wise, like, the other way. Like,
yeah, heavier Nightwing
issue. That'd be really cool.
Yeah.
Very smart.
Smart.
Very, very smart, right? Okay, I think that was basically everything I read, yeah.
Dave?
No.
You're in Canberra.
Yeah.
All right. I read Lion and the Eagle.
Yeah, yep. How is
I'm not going to be around next week. I think you get more issues in, so you guys will actually get to read it.
Yeah.
I really...
Well, maybe, I don't know. One goes to you and one goes to him. And the third one might get him in.
I really enjoyed it. Yeah, Garth Ennis, World War One. There's some really brutal. I don't want to say too much, but yeah, it's a story of essentially this British soldier and his time through. There's some flashbacks about how he met different people, interactions with different Chinese soldiers, American soldiers. This American doctor who he met, and there's some real carnage in that section there, and some really the art's amazing. It's just it's beautifully put together. It's a great war story. I'm really intrigued to see where it goes in the next issue. I'm really glad I picked it up. And I'm really glad you got some more coming because I told my mate that I've got an issue sitting there for him, which will be that issue if they don't come in this week. So I don't have an issue if that happens. Evan, you're a bastard. I shouldn't have opened my mouth before I realized there was no issues left. But yeah, won't say much more than that. You guys will probably talk about it more next week. You get to read it. It's really, really enjoyable. The art's beautiful. Just the big. There's a couple of big scenes with just all the aeroplanes, the artillery, and just some big landscape scenes that are really cool. So yeah, cool World War One story.
No one does war books better than him.
Oh, for sure.
Gods of Brutality issue 4. So this was a story of a heavy metal singer that went to hell, and when he got there, he realized where he was and everything that was going on. So he just started praying to anyone and anyone that would listen to try and get him out of hell. And at one point, it was... So he ended up going for Thor and Hercules, who are a different Thor and Hercules that you see in, you know, our other mainstream media these days. Not mainstream comics. And they're helping him because they want to get more notoriety back in the human world. So they're going to help him because he said... Whoever helps me, I'll write songs about you, and you know you'll be famous and all this stuff. So they're helping him break out of prison. So this is the fourth issue. They're just dumb shits, and it is just there's really good metal references in it. This one part they're in now, they've got these lava monsters where they wanted this section. Like, oh, this place smells amazing. Because everything smells like bacon. And they look around and it's all the fat people in hell getting cooked for these lava monsters. And there's this lava queen. They were sent to the lava queen by these mud witches to get her heart so they could get through. It's just full on. They've met this other rocker chick now who's calling him Danzig and shit. And he's trying to talk about how he used to party with Glenn Danzig. And it's just, balls of all craziness. If you like your metal, you like your hell stuff, you like a bit of a laugh, there's a lot of swearing in it. Gods of Brutality has been really good. This is the end of the first arc, so four issues. So it comes back in the winter. So I've been really enjoying that. And the other craziness was Heavy Metal Drummer.
Sold out.
Mm.
Did anyone else look at it?
I got a brief look at it, and it looked like some Secret Invasion looking thing.
Essentially, yeah. So it just starts with these guys having a concert. The lead singer's a bit of a dick, yelling at the drummer saying, don't stuff up this gig again like you did last time. He starts playing and his music starts this quake of across the dimensions,
and these aliens come up, and it is just, it's an acid trip, man. It is nuts. I'll bring it back to the shop so you can have a flip, because like it comes to these like you said, secret invasion shapeshifters where they turn into three female prostitutes and then they're just banging all these guys out of nowhere, and then these other they're turning into other things. I don't know.
Wow.
But it is it's a bit smaller than normal comic book.
Okay, for a weird show. I didn't even realize it was weird until you were buying the stuff the other day. I'm like, oh, you've got a miscut comic. They're all like that.
And the colouring, the art's not great, but for what it is, it works really well. It's like dirty ugly. Yeah. But yeah, guy was a heavy metal drummer and he had a Black Sabbath t-shirt on the cover and I had a flick and went, oh, I'm going to buy this. So, and I'm really glad I did.
I've got nothing to play with.
So I didn't bring comic book guy. I think that's it.
That's a lot of books.
Heavy Metal Drumming. If you get more issues in, highly recommend it, because it is a heavy metal highway.
All right.
That was all you read?
Yeah, I think so.
I was waiting for that to happen. Roll off the table. Yes.
I caught it. And
Steel Trap.
I read like 14 books. Actually, I read Superior 4. Doctor. Superior 4. I read that as well from last week. That was good. Dr. Doom all over it.
Mm.
It's an Otto Doom.
Mm-hmm.
Because they're all just Ottos, right?
Yeah.
Like Otto Hulk.
They're all clones.
Otto, hey?
They're all kind of clones, aren't they?
No, they're all multiverse Ottos.
Oh.
But it's like, so like...
One got Gamma Ray.
Yeah. One's Ghost Rider. One's Wolverine. That's the whole
point. Okay, cool.
Yeah, yeah. So it's like the new Fantastic Four, but they're all Ottos.
and then
they come across, because they're sort of trying to kill off, I think, the rest of the Ottos, or what's
that? Oh, it's like the one?
Yeah, a bit. And then, like, Doom's, there's like a Doom Otto who tells them that you're all useless. I should be in charge. You're going to ruin everything.
It's Dr. Doom.
Because proper Otto's just going hardcore. I'm going to kill this one. It was just fun. Just fun. I'm a big fan of the new Fantastic Four. Always like those. And so it's them, but weird. So I like that. That's about all.
Wow.
Alrighty, had some new comic announcements this week. Chip Zdarsky on Batman.
Yes.
Yeah. With Jorge Jimenez. Yes.
Like when I seen that, you're like, oh, yeah. Zdarsky on Batman, that sounded good. Oh,
yeah.
Jorge. Oh, yes, please.
And long run, right? They say.
Huh? What?
What's Jimenez doing at the moment?
Different. Like Wonder Woman in Jimenez?
No. Yeah.
Different one.
Different one?
Okay. Yeah.
I feel Jimenez, no.
Yeah. He, this Jimenez did, Super Sons and Superman and a previous run of Batman.
Mm.
Cool.
And I think some Justice League as well.
Yes.
I'm still none the wiser, but thank you.
He's great. He's so good. I want him on Superman.
Okay.
I want him back on Superman.
Yeah. Like that's a top 18.
So it's nice that Chip's doing a bit of a origin thing at the moment. Like you said, a few of those elements might pop into.
Yeah.
It'd be really cool.
Yeah.
And
Batman's needed something. Like the... It's
been a while since Snyder.
The Williams run, Williamson run's okay. And the Tinian run was okay. The end of Tom King was okay. Like, there's not been a lot of hype about Batman, really, since the wedding. When they dropped the ball on the wedding, Batman feels like... And, you know, there's a bit of a spike with the City of Bane thing, a little bit with the Joker War, a little bit with Punchline. But really, Batman... Yeah, it ain't the number one selling book like it was the whole 52 era.
It looks like, again, like I'm not reading it, but from the outside it looks like filler.
Yes.
Just until the next big name can come on.
Treading water.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
Next thing was Al Ewing on Ant-Man, right?
Oh, yeah. Just a little mini, I think.
Four-pointer.
Yeah. But,
That's awesome.
Yes. Focusing on, each is just going to focus on a different Ant-Man.
Yeah.
The first one's Hank Pym, and it's going to have Scott Lang and...
Erica Grady.
Yeah. I think there's going to be another one as well.
Yeah, and, the future one, I think.
Oh, yeah, the future one. That's right.
I want to read that Irredeemable stuff.
Irredeemable was one of my favorite comics of all time. Come on, Marvel.
Please. I have money for you.
So I'd buy the guy who's doing the Thing mini at the moment.
Yes, which fits, right? Like, he's got that old school vibe. Because that's what I always think about Ant-Man. You think of a sort of throwback art, right?
Yeah, we got those Ant-Man minis on Disney Channel.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, you watch some of
them? They're awesome little throwback. Yeah. Old school animation.
Oh, that's so weird.
Not ones that scare Nitin. We'll talk about that later, but
But yeah, that's what it reminded me of when I saw it. And then I liked the difference between the four boxes because of the different style periods that we're going to get.
It's like the scientist, the criminal, the whatever. And I'm like, oh, yeah, man. Because yeah, Iron Deal or Airman, one of the most underrated Marvel comics of the last...
big time.
20 years now, I guess. Yeah. I would love for him to re-put that trade in print because it's been a long time.
That was like a digest size,
yeah,
right?
It was.
They did a full-size trade as well.
I got a full-size trade.
But yeah, they did do the judges, which I thought was smart.
Yeah, yeah, that's so well. Funny.
Yeah, but such a great book, just fun, and like, just he was so cool, he was so different, and like, it was also such a book of its time. Like, it span out of Enemy of the State. Like, his origin is from the Wolverine Enemy of the State storyline.
Okay,
because like Enemy of the State, like one of the things in that is the helicarrier gets crashed, right? Mm. Wolverine, because Wolverine's killing everyone on the helicarrier because he's being brainwashed. So the Ant-Man, while the helicarrier is crashing, he steals the... he's just a S.H.I.E.L.D. agent that steals the Ant-Man suit to save himself. Because he's just an asshole. But, you know, like, so at the time, it was just... you know, like, when everything was tied in so good at the time, Marvel, you know, like, Civil War start, you know, like,
yeah,
everything was very tight,
yeah,
early 2000s. But it was such a good book.
That reminds me, I haven't read any of the State either.
It's good.
You need to read that.
Yeah. I think I've read one Wolverine thing, and that's Old Man Logan. Okay.
And when Nitin says that about a Mark Miller book, yeah, would you read it?
But it's not like Mark Miller. It's
interest strange, yeah, Mark Miller. Well,
kind of.
It's a straightforward comic book story. It's not so like...
And Remitter Jr.
Yeah, Remitter. Yeah. Good Remitter.
Oh, okay,
yeah, great. Good Remitter.
Anyway,
a little rough, but it worked in the story. Yeah. But and Wolverine, you know. Yeah.
As long as it's not Action Comics level.
Do you like my rah?
Gonna miss it.
Was that everything?
Was there something else? What was the other one?
We spoke about Human Target already.
Oh, yeah. Maybe that's what I was thinking about.
Yeah, I think that was
it. We still love you.
Yeah.
We also got some brand new action figures in the store.
Yes.
We'll start with...
well, brand new. We'll go the new Marvel Legends for Doctor Strange, basically. What do you call it? What's the movie called? Multiverse of Madness.
It's too long for you to remember.
I just don't care about Multiverse. It's a problem. So we got a build up of the like Bison Man or whatever he is.
Yeah.
Still in the trailer.
Rintra. So the wave's got the new Doctor Strange, new Wong, America Chavez, new Mordo.
Sleepwalker.
Sleepwalker. Comic Sleepwalker. Despair. And Sleep Comic Despair. And what do you call it?
Astral
Doctor Strange. But as usual, my legends look good. I just bought the one because we're on location.
Yes.
I made Dylan bring it, actually. Mm-hmm. I was going to come out and bring it myself, and I was like,
what's the point?
Yeah,
I'm already there.
Yeah.
Yes.
And I had to go get cake.
Yeah.
Alrighty. We also got in... this one, I think, has maybe been around a few places. We got it a bit late. Sometimes we legends, we do. Sometimes we'll be the first place in the country to get it. Sometimes we'll be the last place. Especially big movie time ones, I think that happens. This is Spider-Man, No Way Home sort of wave. You build the armadillo.
Not with that figure.
What? Huh?
Not with that figure.
Yeah, Spider-Man, ain't coming up. But yeah, build an armadillo.
Okay.
So this wave's got No Way Home Spidey, the black inverted suits.
Yeah, inside out suit.
A Doctor Strange that... is slightly different from that Doctor Strange. J. Jonah Jameson. Nice. Which has two heads. And I think a missed opportunity that the other head ain't classic...
Buzzcut.
Yeah.
Box head.
But we're talking, I'm like, surely we might get a Raimi wave.
I think you will.
A Raimi wave?
Yeah.
Anyway. And then Miles from the game universe. Comic Morlun and Shriek.
Ooh, oh, Miles, no, I will. I'll be upset about it.
Huh?
Yeah, I wouldn't mind the gaming ones, actually. Did they release a gaming Spidey?
Yeah. That quite a few.
Yeah.
All the different costumes and stuff.
Is there a face?
Gameverse?
Yeah. Like a Peter?
Yeah, like... because they changed it for PS5 from PS4.
Yeah. So. I don't know. Not an unmasked.
So
no.
Yeah. Okay, cool.
And also, back in stock this week.
Yeah.
The Real Ghostbusters Kenner Collection. Flashback to the good old 80s action figures. Pretty much exactly the same. Mm. Just the... ignore the back. Just the four Ghostbusters. Because for some reason, Hasbro didn't give Australia Sloan or Stay Puft. But the Ghostbusters are cool. We had these in... a while back. Yeah. And it sold out fast, but we got some more in.
It sold out again.
Yeah. Speaking of Ghostbusters, I meant to mention it last week. But sad news with Reitman passing away.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, that was, you're like, man, we just got the movie.
Yeah.
And, oh, man, sad. I forgot to mention it last week. But
And cool that they, Ivan Reitman played Egon in the movie.
Right, so you like
the astral version. That's so
cool.
The fact that he got to do that.
That was probably shot 2.5 years ago. Probably. The movie got delayed so many times.
Yes. But the fact that he got to see that released. Right? 100%. And the fact that he got to pass it on to his son.
Yeah. You know.
I think there's something in my eye again.
Yes. But I love these figures when I was a kid. Still got my four from when I was a kid. But they're just perfect.
I love the little ghost they come with. I used to have the Venkman. I used to have that little blue one.
I'm so torn. I want to buy him. But I'm like, I got them. They're exactly the same, but these are clean. My Ray's got diseased. He's got like plastic disease or spotty.
Yeah.
And Venkman's got a busted string.
I'm sure you could get it.
I know they're cheap, but...
I know someone that works at the shop. He might be able to hook you up, Bill.
I don't know where I got space for him.
That's the problem. We'll buy it and keep it in my place.
And you've got the new ones. The new Slimer and the Stay Puft.
Oh, they're not available, right? Those two?
You can get them online.
Oh, okay. Right.
But not available in the country, but you can purchase them online. I got mine off Amazon.
Oh, cool.
Ray as well, because I remember that one with the curly tail.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They did a re-release Ecto as well for some reason. That is not coming locally. And I'm like, man, I would be able to sell a million of those. Because even people that have like the vintage, not everyone's got, that might have the vintage toys, but they didn't have the car at the time because the car's an expensive thing.
Yeah.
I got my car.
It's the only car you got. No need for another one.
It might be accurate.
Yeah.
Some Batmobile. Actually, Dylan, I got toys today. Beck picked it up. She was at shops. The Gnor. Sharktacon, right?
Oh, yeah, cool.
Yeah, I don't transform my Transformers because it's too hard. But I didn't want him in robot mode. I want him in Sharktacon mode.
Oh, so you transform your Transformer?
I transform my Transformer. Those instructions tell you nothing. That's arrow. I had to watch a YouTube video.
That's like a Legends class, right? Or basic or whatever.
It's a deluxe.
Oh, deluxe?
Yeah,
I'm so confused with step by bloody step.
Yeah, it's too hard.
They're fine. I can follow them.
Well, the YouTube didn't have words, but at least had stuff. What? I'm like, what do you mean? What?
They're so straightforward.
Nah, I'm no good at it.
They're so easy to follow.
Yeah, I know.
It's because I hate making things. I hate doing things. God, I hate making things.
Could have paid Dave to make it.
Well, Dave should pay you to make it. That's his rules, right?
Yes.
Yeah, but I don't want it, so it's all
good. Well, that's it. I'm sitting there, I'm like, maybe I'll just have to leave him as the robot. But I'm like, no, he's gonna be a shark.
Was it really deluxe class?
Yeah, well, deluxe. It's deluxe.
Okay, I thought that was smaller. Deluxe. Maybe I'm thinking of previous version. Maybe
it's not. It's not this big.
Oh, okay.
He's taller than like Cliffjumper and Bumblebee, but
yeah, because I think they did one before and it was a Legend small one or something. Yeah,
it was cool, but now I'm gonna buy Alicorn.
What if that one comes in robot mode?
No, it doesn't. I think it does, but I think I'd
is that what you
robot
want?
Mode.
Oh, okay.
Because he looks cool in robot mode. And he's robot mode in most of the movie. The shark's a shark in the movie. Anyway, that's enough of my ranting about my toy purchases of the week. What's next, Dylan?
Toy related.
Yes.
Sets, Lego sets for Thor, Love and Thunder.
Mm.
I think it was just, one set or multiple?
One set, because it was the back of the front. The
longboat.
You got more from the back shot of the longboat with the gore in the...
Yeah, so it was, a longboat. Pulled by Thor's goats.
Yeah.
From the comics and the mythology. It's really cool to see them in the movie.
Yeah.
And
the longbow.
Yeah.
The longbow. It's awesome. You got and Valkyrie in the kit. You've got Gore in the kit. So Christian Bale's character in the movie.
So your first look at Gore.
Yeah. So he's the got back of it. So we'll show a picture of the back of the box with the Necro sword. And you've also got, I think Korg was in there as well. And I think Lady Thor was in there as well.
Officially known as Mighty Thor. You've got Mighty Thor and you've got Thor. That's not going to get confusing.
Yeah, she's got the patched up together Mjolnir.
Yeah.
And he's got Stormbreaker.
What do you got to do? You got to give it. You can't get a chick fall.
Lady Thor.
Yeah, you got to.
That was the unofficial fan name for a while, right?
And that's what they did with the book, but right, like her second volume book,
Mighty
Thor, works for me.
Yeah.
Well, like I hate Ragnarok, right? But I'm actually, this might be all right. Because if there's not much Thor in it, I can handle a lighter tone if it's Jane.
Yeah.
The comedy-ness will not annoy me as much if it's Jane Foster, because it's Jane Foster. Where, goddamn, Asgardian warrior Thor, I don't want a goddamn joke fest, people. But...
yeah, like a human woman...
but a chick dying of cancer? Yeah. Hilarious!
I don't think they'll put that in the movie, I reckon.
You don't reckon she should be dying?
It's nah. So...
oh, well, that'll annoy the crap out of me.
Yeah, I don't think they'll do it.
It's a perfect redemption.
Yeah.
Of course they will. She's fighting it, and now she has the power to do it. Come on, dude. It's 2021.
And she's got it from the ether, right?
Yes.
That's what the thing will be. They'll be maybe, they might not 100% say, but I think that'll be the... or when they've tried to fix her on Asgard or whatever. Like, definitely the... no one Thor is why she got it, you know? Spider-Man Rain star. missed opportunity.
Yeah, especially for down the track, because it's not like they're going to stop the character. They're going to keep it going, and then down the track she'll probably be Valkyrie. So, or a Valkyrie with... so then they'll still be able to continue that storyline down the track.
I will say, I was always bitterly disappointed in the comics that they just didn't kill her off when it came to its end. Yeah. I think that... because what I loved in the in her story in the comic was she refused Thor and Asgard's help.
Yeah.
Because she's a doctor. She's like, we can beat cancer. I believe in our systems and whatever, and I don't want your magic rubbish. Mm-hmm. I'll fight it my way. And I just wish she died. I just make it better. Like,
have more impact, yeah, for sure.
But, you know.
Comics.
It's good that people don't die of cancer. Cancer's bad. Yeah, I'm actually looking forward to the movie. Bad.
Keep that in mind.
I give this to Marvel, though. Captain Marvel, when he died of cancer, they've kept
that. Because it was excellent. You know, they brought him back here and there as teasers and other thing and this and that.
Yeah, like, it was only temporary.
Yeah, never tried to
do it properly.
Because it was excellent. That's why it's one of the best deaths. They've left it. Mm-hmm. And also, man, you can't fight some stuff.
And you can only... do things... you can only bring people back in great ways so many times. Yes. Like, you've done it a lot of bad ways, but like, Bucky, that was brilliant.
Yeah.
Like, it probably should have, but then the way they did it, you're happy that he brought him back, because that's just...
what's it created? It's all cool, but I'll still... I would have... if they never brought him back, I'd be even...
100%, but what we got...
yeah, no, Winter Soldier rules.
What we got from it, nah. Very like, much preferred.
Winter Soldier story arc by Brubaker is freaking fantastic.
100%.
But it never happened.
So be it as well, but...
you would know what you lost, though, if it never happened. Yeah. But yeah, no, he's the best bring back ever. What else next, Dylan?
Fami, Cuphead Show.
Yeah.
We both finished it. It was 10 episodes? 12 episodes.
12 10-minute episodes.
Yes.
I can't get enough of the show. It's so fun. It's so easy to watch. It's so easy to watch for like so many different. Like you could show a 3-year-old that show without a problem whatsoever, and kind of like Simpsons in a different way, where it's more like 10, 12-year-olds and 20-year-olds are laughing at the same joke for different reasons. But the sinisterness and the little side little gags and stuff that are in it just keep adults enjoying it as well.
I think it's a sign of a good cartoon, right?
It really does. It's great writing. I also found a little bit of more sinisterness in it, maybe, or just find me looking too much into a bloody cartoon that goes for 10 minutes and is about a 30s, 40s style video game. But if you have a look at the show, there's an episode, which I think is probably the best episode, in the cemetery.
That was great, yeah.
Just the also all the backgrounds and the way that whole episode was done. But... everyone is anthropomorphic, whether it be utensils and cutlery like they are as Cuphead, or it's animals that have been come to life and act like humans with clothing and eating and all the rest of the normal stuff. But the only humans you see in the whole show are ghosts. So there's no one else, like, no one else in the whole show is an actual human except the people that are dead, which can bring up some really cool sinister stuff in the background, because, you know, what happened, was there a magic spell or anything, like, it made
that's
everything
alive? That's why things are, humanized or...
exactly right.
Whatever.
But then speaking to Dylan about it, I haven't actually played the game. He's saying there's humans in the game.
Yes.
But that's not television canon, so I'm still going with mine.
Captain Briny Beard was in the intro. He's a pirate.
That's great. He's not in the show.
He might be in the background somewhere.
Unless he was the one buying the supplies that was in the hood in the third last episode.
Maybe he was in the background somewhere. I don't know.
But yeah, everything around it, the devil, the accountant that was counting all the souls, because the devil was pretending that he had, the whole thing was around the devil wanting Cuphead's soul and going after it. And
it's cheating.
The devil is a real lazy piece of shit, which is great. I was saying it reminded me of the devil from a little bit like Cow and Chicken. And what we're talking about, great TV show, finished on a cliffhanger for us. So I don't know when we're going to get the rest.
That took me by surprise because it's been so old school and just self-contained episodes. And all of a sudden, cliffhanger. And I was like, what?
And
what is this?
And not just that, you introduce a brand new character, which is like a main character in this last episode. And she's so perfect because she's the embodiment of exactly the, like, the Betty Boop and everything like that, where she just sings and everyone loves her and everyone just gives her anything and everything for free. That's how she gets. Yeah. So then the boys try and do it and then they all get in trouble every time they try and do it until she comes in, and then it's so well done. I also love the fact that Nitin is afraid of it. So that makes me love it more.
I'm not afraid of it. It's like animation style.
I'm not afraid of cartoons.
It just freaks me out. I don't like it.
Yeah.
So anyway, show you three. So, yeah. Just not Nitin.
What about, like, if it's a real, like, you're freaked out watching Steamboat Willie, like, you know what I mean? Or is it just the modern stuff making it look old? Is that the problem? Like,
it's old stuff too, right?
Yeah, it's old stuff too. Oh, I just don't like
the old time.
Well, like the early Bugs Bunny kind of stuff.
Now Bugs Bunny is fine. It's like the black and white old time cartoons where they all move like in synchronized.
Oh yeah. Have you seen the skeleton dance?
Yeah, that's excellent. I don't like that.
Oh wow.
Marionette-y.
Yeah, it's, I don't know. It's something about it that just twigs me. I don't like it.
That's why I was thinking that the other day. I was like, is it just the old stuff too, or is it just the modern stuff trying to look old?
Getting a Steamboat Itchy animation cell.
Yeah, I'm watching it, like, Dave. Had me playing the game again. The game's awesome.
I'm going to buy the game.
Yeah.
Yeah, I got to buy the game.
It's available on PlayStation 4 now. Switch, Xbox, PC. It's everywhere. It's really good. I'm pretty sure I told everyone to buy the game last week as well. But yeah, it's great.
But yeah, like, and like you were saying, like, pretty much every episode is one of the bosses that you're fighting in the...
Yeah, basically.
I think
yeah.
one of the other standouts was the, another standout episode was the vegetables.
And they call the root pack?
Yes.
Yes.
And having a big fruit party, orgy, stealing all the water. It's crazy. But then the other episode, because they've got Grandpa Kettle, who looks after them, Cuphead and Mugboy. And, Mugman.
He's a man.
And they've got a worm in their room and they're talking about keeping it. But their grandpa is listening in, thinking they're kill the grandpa because he's old and decrepit and all this stuff. Yeah. So he gets all his army stuff on and like full old school,
like World War One helmet,
and fully booby traps the house, like full, like top tier Home Alone shit, like bear traps and snares, and it's crazy. All because he thinks they're trying to kill him and he was trying to get them first. You're gonna have to take me alive. It's so damn good. Yeah, and like, you wouldn't expect that for a kid's cartoon.
No, absolutely not.
But it still works.
And they've got some music from the games mixed in as well.
All right.
The soundtrack to the game is exactly like the show. Just jazz, big band stuff.
That was another standout, the dice, the roll of the dice game show.
Yeah. That was awesome. Wayne Brady voicing King
was
Dice.
It?
Yeah.
Awesome.
And the whole thing, they've kind of... watered down is not the right word, but they've kind of kiddified it a little bit because, in the game, King Dice is the manager for the Devil's Casino, and Cuphead loses his soul because he lost the game of, you know, blackjack or whatever at the casino. So they turn... How do you make that for kids? Ski ball!
Yep.
And that's the start of that, Khan Evil, and then everyone was losing their souls and everything like that. It's a very dark way to start, but... It's still light. It's
Yeah. I can't wait for more. I'm trying to play more of the game, but it's scary because it's hard.
So what everyone says. It's the hardest kids game ever.
Yes. Alrighty. Time to get into some movies. Yeah. The Kingsman.
Yeah. So I wanted to watch this at the cinemas, and then I saw an ad saying, on Disney Plus on February 22nd or 23rd. I'm like... okay, I can watch that at home happily. I really enjoyed the first two Kingsman movies. The second one didn't get anywhere near as good ratings, unfortunately, but I still really enjoyed it. I liked the way they did the drug thing. Julianne Moore was awesome. Her whole setup was everything.
It wasn't as good as the first one. The first one was excellent. But it was matched that. It was a damn good fun movie.
I was actually quite shocked when I looked it up last night.
Elton John stuff?
Forgot about the Elton John stuff. Great. Yeah, Dana definitely needs to watch that now. But like, the first one got a 7.7, then the second one got a 6.7. And I was like quite shocked at that. And then I looked at this and it got a 6.4. So I didn't know what to expect going into it, because obviously it was going back to the start of how the Kingsman began. Ralph Fiennes in it. I always ruin this guy's name. He's in Guardians of the Galaxy. What's his name? The black gentleman. Yes. African.
Peter Digimon?
Yes. What's his?
I don't know his last name.
Okay.
I think he just like went by Digimon for a while too.
Well, we know who was called
Digimon.
I don't know.
Yeah, I know.
But when I think we first started, I think it just went by the first name.
He's excellent.
Yeah, both names are hard though. I can't say them.
He's fighting in it, everything. So it was really, if you're going and expecting what you've seen for the last two movies, don't expect, you're not going to be happy. But I think you're going to enjoy what you get. Like, it's essentially going through the story of King Ferdinand. You've got, it's essentially like a cabal of bad people that are intercepting around World War One. So working with the three cousins. So you had Wilhelm, you had the King of England, and you had the German Wilhelm, and who was the guy in Russia before Lenin? What's his freaking name? Stalin? Anyway, no, not Stalin.
That's after,
buddy. So, and then you've got all their, so they're all in power, but then everyone that's in their ear is in part of this kind of cabal. So you've got Rasputin, and you've got Nemo from Winter Soldiers. What's his name? The actual actor? I can't think of it. The guy that played Nemo. Yeah. He's into...
What, Zemo?
Zemo, not Nemo. Sorry, guys. Zemo. Thank you, Dave. You knew what my rabble was going on about. So it's going through that time, and the story itself is Ralph Fiennes and his son and him growing up trying to keep him safe, and then it becomes a full war movie, and then it becomes a full action adventure movie. It goes for over 2 hours. It takes on a lot of different things. It doesn't nail everything, but it's a really enjoyable ride. The way they build the Secret Service, which becomes the Kingsmen, up together, is really, really cool. It takes a little bit to get into it, but once it starts rolling, it's quite enjoyable. So I'd be intrigued. I'm sure you guys will watch it. Mm-hmm.
I forgot it was on.
I definitely give it more like a 7.5 to an 8 than a 6.4. But I've again, Vaughn co-wrote and directed it as well, so it really keeps that whole trilogy in. There's a lot of other little things too. If you haven't watched the first two that came out, probably watch them first, because you see reasons why
things happen.
Oh, like the knife in the shoes and different things like that. Oh. It actually happens in a thing where he attaches it, and that is way that he tries to escape somewhere. So there's some really cool other elements that you'll get out of it if you've seen those other first two films as well. So yeah, highly recommend it.
Awesome. Cool. Interesting. Film flashback for me.
Yes.
How did you like that film flashback? The Babadook.
Okay. So, Australian horror movie, 2014, The Babadook. I really enjoyed the premise. I thought the story and the way that it could have come together was really good. I don't know if it was executed as well as it could have been. The acting was great. That kid was
phenomenal.
Phenomenal.
And everything. Being the kid with clearly some issues, the kid that you just want to slap, the darkness, like the evil kid, the looking after his mum, like he had a lot of different elements to work with, and nailed them all.
Brightburn kid here, Babadook kid here. Yeah. Like, man, he nailed it.
Yeah.
He was great. The mum was good, but not great. But, again, hard to...
I did like that everyone looked like real people and not actors.
Yes. Mm. Yeah, that's very true. The only thing I didn't like, and this is no fault to the movie, it's more the fault to... I've seen Snowtown, and the guy that was trying to be nice to her that worked in the nursing home is the piece of shit in Snowtown, and I can't dislike when I see the
the brother from Get Out now, all I can see is Martin Bryant. It's, yeah. So that did annoy me, but there's nothing to do with the actual film. Are we going to go right into spoilers and everything? Like, we're talking,
yeah.
The end did annoy me, like, just because she stood up to it, now she just... It kind of reminded me at the end of, like, You Mean Love in the Dark. Like, now she's just got a spirit that's just there living, like, not the love side of it, but, like...
Yeah, I thought it was an odd choice to end.
It was an odd choice of ending.
No, like, the whole time, she's just gaslighting her son to make him behave.
Oh, Dave.
That's not the movie at all.
Dave.
I would agree a lot, though. Like, the movie was good, but I thought a little drawn out at times. Yes. I know the bitch is crazy.
And it's only an hour and a half.
And you're seeing it, but...
It was only an hour and a half, and it still felt drawn out at pieces.
Yeah,
pace yeah.
A bit,
Especially the start, I was like, oh, God.
Because the book shit was... And give me a bit more around the book and the... Because... And the art. Jeez, the art in that book was amazing.
I did like, when you see the Babadook, it looks like it's made out of paper.
Yes.
Yeah. Because of the story and how it moves like it's made out of paper. I did like that.
Except the bit where it flies down into her mouth or whatever.
The greatness and the atmosphere was great. Yeah. But I think it could have...
Just the execution.
A little bit faster maybe at times. Or maybe cut a scene or two or something. I don't know.
Yeah.
I just felt like I watched the same thing for about an hour.
But the kid, I just can't get... over everything. Oh, and the little girl. I would have pushed her out the bloody tree house as well, little shit. Reminded me of the little, you know, what was it? Problem child, the little bitch in that.
Yeah.
But yeah, like, it had great moments, but it was the best thing to come out of the Scream movie that came out this year. Because that's the only reason I found out about this film. I don't know. What else? What did you guys?
Yeah, I agree. Like,
because you've already seen it, haven't you?
Yeah. The atmosphere and the...
Sorry. Thanks for telling us about the dog death, you prick.
Yeah, no worries.
Seriously, man. Gotta
keep that a
heads up, man. Come on.
Hey, I didn't know about it. No one else is going to know about it. All right? If I have to go through that,
fair enough. Sorry, please.
Yeah, I do agree. The atmosphere and the tension and the suspense definitely, like, the strongest parts of the movie.
Yeah. And, like, her spiral, a bit... Shinning style, like, you know what I mean? Yeah. Like, it was cool, but maybe too much at the start of the kid's just a shit kid. Well, that's your fault. And like, I get, like, she's
7 years.
Yeah, like, I get she's obviously got depression and hasn't dealt with what has happened. And you don't want to, but you're like, man, like.
She does proper parenting as soon as she gets possessed, though.
but is it the spirit?
Well, it's going shit.
That was excellent. The spirit pretending to be the husband, or was the spirit the husband? Because because the way the neighbor was talking about the husband, he seemed like a nice bloke. He wasn't a piece of shit, so I'm guessing it wasn't. But yeah,
it was good, but could have been better.
Yeah, it had great potential.
Mm. The ending was a bit disappointing.
Yeah. The ending's very.
It could have killed someone. Like,
the dog doesn't count
in the movie.
No, I was
like a. Human,
But that's not its deal. It possesses the person and, you know, wants to kill them.
Or maybe, like, beforehand.
It's not like it's going to go out and start murdering people.
No, but let's say you see the book beforehand and, like, someone's dead, but you see the book. And then all of a sudden, like,
I like the way, because that's what I'm like, oh, that book. And Dana's watching. She's like, well, kids just come home with stuff all the time. Mm-hmm. So you just could have picked that up anywhere and. It's in the.
You could have picked it up at a garage sale where the owner died or something. You know?
I don't know. I like it better not having an origin. I don't want an origin to the book. It's just so creepy.
Spoon fed Dave. Bloody spoon fed Dave.
But, like, here we go. It took too long to get to it, you know? Like, you don't see the book till, like, what, a third of the way through?
I'm happy with the build up in regards up to there, but it was too much of. Shit kid. There should have been some more mystical, not mystical shit, but some other...
And like the monster at the start where she's always checking the closets and that, like, they're essentially unrelated now, you know, so...
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know about unrelated.
Well, you don't see it.
No, right? But it's a little kid in a big old house.
Yeah. I know. And it means he's susceptible to falling into the Babadook thing, I feel. And because he's all messed up, and then she's all messed up, and everyone's all messed up.
Oh, yeah. And there's no sleep.
The sister, man. Oh, that was some cool stuff with the sister.
I'm really tired from the drugs mum gave me. Oh, thanks, Dad. That's the docks worker. Especially in South Australia. Jesus.
Yeah. That was messed up.
And then they look to each other and they fall her into the kitchen. That was.
My favourite bitch was the car, but like when she's coming in the car, she freaks out. Yeah. It was really great stuff, but some stuff was a little too drawn out.
And the mystery of that meme got answered for you that you were talking about from a few years back about the why can't she just be normal?
Yeah.
I'd never said
that. That's why Beck was like, "Oh, that's what I'm like." Oh,
yeah.
I'm not a big meme person.
Oh, I'd love a meme, but I haven't seen that one.
What's the ratings for these ones?
It's a hard one to rate, I feel.
Six.
I'm gonna give it like 6.5.
I think I've got to go 7 because the kid was so good.
Yeah, he sort of saves it.
Yeah, I might get 6.
And the wife and the mother toy.
Well, I was gonna go up. I had 6.5. I was at 7, but then the dude from Snowtown brought down 6.5 for me. No fault to his own.
See, if she had just had him around, she.
Well, he could have died. He could have been the one to say, no, you need to get, like, because it's a family thing. Yes. So that could have been the
person. Well, I thought he was going to maybe come to try to
do something.
Cop some. I did think maybe. But I assumed it.
But yeah, also, sorry, that stuff with the sister, there was some thoughts.
There's some cool stuff.
Yeah,
I don't want to come to your house. It's depressing.
Yeah.
Do you think her using, like, the vibrator was a bit odd in there?
No, she's a single mum, 7 years alone. Like, she still needs pleasure. Like, that's life. And she's everything else is falling around.
Oh, and I thought its whole point wasn't even.
It was the build up, too.
It was that she can't get a moment to herself.
Yeah.
You
know what I mean? Because that's where she's starting to get really more.
And it's just run down. She asked for the drugs, too.
Yeah.
So.
She's like, fine. Oh, he's out. Yeah. I can just. Me time more than even the sexualness.
Dana's like, she's using that shoulder massager wrong.
So what is next?
Yeah, it was.
Yeah. Oh yeah, so 6.
6.
Yeah, I'll go 7.
7.
6.5.
6.5.
6.
6. Alright, cool.
Well, that wraps up our Australia round.
Yes.
All around Australia.
Yeah.
Alright, I'm next, right?
Yep.
You are.
And we don't tell them the theme, right?
No. Our discretion.
Yes.
Our discretion.
Our discretion.
Maybe at the end.
Yeah.
Alright.
Pretty sure you're going to be able to work out a theme.
I know.
You tell them Kurt Russell.
Well, no, I'm going to tell them now.
Ah.
Because why not? It's obvious.
Yes.
Better say correctly.
We're going video game movies for my round.
Well, now it's obvious.
I'm pretty sure after I say that my movie is Prince of Persia and then next week...
It's whatever.
Someone says Street Fighter.
An animated strip. Yeah.
That's how we're changing now.
Yes.
Hey, yeah, I meant the live action Street Fighter.
No, you didn't.
No,
I did.
Yeah,
I
did.
Yeah, I did. No, I legit did.
No, we're not watching that shit.
Because I want to watch it.
No. Okay.
You can watch it in your own damn time.
You're getting some Plumber Brothers next week.
Hey. Yes, my movie is Prince of Persia.
I never watched that.
Sands of Time.
Yeah, I've never seen it either.
It's on Disney.
It's not for crazy amount. We're just getting bagged. I'm like, I don't give a shit.
It's really fun. I enjoyed it.
He was my problem.
Yeah, Jake Gyllenhaal.
Yeah, it just not even anything against him, but it just reeked of... Oh, look, this guy's hot and famous.
Yeah.
And I like him as an actor.
Yeah, me too, but I was like,
Yeah.
He's a Prince of Persia now?
Yeah. It just
really?
Felt like, I look, famous guy on the marquee.
Yeah. No, I understand that.
That's fine.
I think, I feel like I got wrongfully slammed, because I think it's a fine action-adventure movie. Yeah. And they picked Sands of Time to kind of turn into a movie, and they had a really cool mechanic where, if you jumped off a platform and fell to your death, you could rewind time and try it again, kind of thing. And they use that really well in the movie.
Mm.
So that is my pick.
I look forward to that. Because I always thought it looked fun.
Yeah.
But yeah, time, and then just, you just don't watch things.
Walk slowly through those spikes. I miss that game. It's such a damn good game.
Ben Kingsley. Can't go wrong with Ben Kingsley. Mm.
Is it true?
That's not true.
What?
Iron Man 3 happened.
Oh, that's true.
He was pretty good in his role. Until
Trevor.
Yeah. That's
different. Yeah, like, he was fine as Mandarin. He became Trevor and just ruined the damn...
I tried to block it out and he was great as the Mandarin. He's better than the Mandarin.
Yeah, just forget about Shang-Chi.
Yeah.
Alright.
But I'll take his Mandarin over the Mandarin we got.
Yeah.
He just wasn't Mandarin-y enough.
It wasn't. They needed long hair.
No, he was just...
No, he needed long hair.
And longer fingernails.
He was not bad, but he's not super villainy enough.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? He was just the dad.
Like, even if he, like, went modern, like he did, like, towards the end. Like,
oh, for sure.
You still want to see the early parts through, like, full costume, full, like, you know,
retro. But I think the deal was that he wasn't like that. It was just a thing made up by
the West. The West. Yes. I understand.
He wasn't like a caricature.
I know, but why can't we have supervillains in these goddamn movies, man? You can have the heroes dressing up in stupid outfits, but the supervillains, oh no, they're going to be real. Piss off. I want some bad guys.
I hate it so much when, like, the devil is, like, just a person. Like,
it depends.
Depending what you're talking about. Like,
what?
Most movies.
Yeah, but if you're talking about, like...
Okay, like, Meet Joe Black is fine.
Mm-hmm.
But, like... No, but, like, the epitome of, like, the concept of the devil. But right. then... Is he death. Right. But, like...
He's deaf. He's not the devil.
Yeah. But then, like...
But, like, in Hellblazer, in Johnny... Yep. He's not... He's just the dude in the suit.
He's the best. Oh, come on. That
Mal movie's a shit.
Oh, that's true. 100%.
But you know what I mean, right? Like,
Hellblazer. Oh, it's Damari. No, I'm out.
Hang on.
I meant Ghost Rider.
Okay.
Hellblazer.
You're gonna say Constantine? That's probably the second best devil on screen besides. It's a shit movie, but his portrayal and his acting is phenomenal. Besides Pacino in Advocate.
Freaking rules.
And De Niro did a pretty good job.
But it depends on the movie, though. Because like,
yeah, I know it depends on the movie.
You can't just have a red.
Yeah, it's not Legend.
Star looking dude.
No, but let's say Wonder Woman, right?
Mm-hmm.
He's not.
What?
I know he's not the devil, but like.
That's a bad example, Dave.
Let's give us another bad example, Dave.
I know what you mean.
You know, like.
What I'm saying is what you mean.
They cheap out and they just go, okay, we'll just make him the human form. And...
But Ares is not the devil.
I know. But you know what?
And shapeshifting is a thing for the devil, right? Shapeshifting.
Yeah, let's use that, manipulate people.
Now, if devil's on Earth, he has to walk around. He's going to be inconspicuous.
He doesn't want you to know he's the devil.
Yeah, no, I want him 8 foot tall with horns and a friggin' tail, Dave.
If you're in hell...
Thank you.
He doesn't want you to know he's the devil.
Yeah. That's the whole point.
He wants your soul.
If you go into hell and he's a
you seen Little Nicky?
In a suit, then there's a problem.
Have you seen Little Nicky? Jesus.
I don't mean just the devil. I mean, like, when films just cop out and go, okay, well...
That's what I said.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Maybe it was
I agree.
Yeah. You agree
with me? I'm with you, Mark. I know what you mean.
You know what I mean.
Yeah. Like, I know what you meant by the Ares thing. He's just a pummy guy.
Yeah.
Instead of the God of War.
Yeah. Hate when movies do that. And that's my point.
Well done, Dave. Point terribly made. Thank you, Jay, for fixing that point.
Yes.
Appreciate it.
Alrighty, that wraps us up for this week.
We'll be closed next Saturday.
Yes,
we will.
We'll be closed next Saturday.
For some idiot.
I'm that idiot.
Are you?
Yeah.
I am that idiot. Is it maybe missing?
Yeah, so I may be missing for the next couple of weeks or three, maybe longer if I've got to be in Hawaii. So I get a report back from Hawaii, perhaps. So yeah, somehow, some way, I've managed to... Well, it hasn't happened yet because... Yeah, but hopefully next Saturday there's a good chance that around 2 o'clock-ish I'll be getting married.
Hey!
So shot will be shot.
Shot shot.
Where are we going? We're just going to shot anyway.
Yeah, they're not invited. They're not these reprimands here. So I'll probably be away for the next couple of weeks. We've got honeymoon in Hawaii, so hopefully do a little bit of reporting, check out a couple of stores.
Hey.
If there's more than one store in Hawaii, it's probably not.
Our Hawaiian correspondents.
We'll have one and see what I can find over there for you boys.
I've been there twice. I'll tell you where
to go. Off you go.
So I'll do my film flashback. I'll give you a report.
Have like a slide photo show when you get back, and we'll incorporate into
that. We can do that. Everyone loves slides.
Yeah. Slides, visual aid for the podcast that we're recording here.
Exactly. Be the only one
because this is working right now.
Episode 50, extravaganza.
What a cake!
It's half a century.
Ice cream cake.
We made 50.
Celebrating 50 episodes, we had to get cake. I said, I don't want normal cake. I'm getting...
Party cake!
That's right. Because we're big boys.
Cake. That's how it goes.
And there's no beer, so you're all right.
That's right.
So please...
I got beer if you want.
I'm not allowed beer and ice cream cake.
Okay. You don't want it.
It's your house.
I know.
For all the people that have made it through 50 episodes, thank you very much for your support and everything like that. We couldn't do it without the 1 to 2 comments we get.
Pretty sure we can do it 100%.
Please tell some more people and some friends who like to be annoyed by our voices for 2 hours a week. We really enjoy doing it, so want to keep it going, and I will be back to annoy you guys in a few weeks' time.
Oh, no.
All right.
With Slideshow.
Slideshow, yes. Slideshow,
yeah.
Jason.
All right. We'll see you guys again next week.
Ice cream cake.
Bye.
Bye.
Let's get into this cake.